reducing these numbers somehow. So yes, please keep in mind there is a difference between what's just a high escape fraction and what's a Lyman alpha galaxy. So I'll talk a little bit briefly about an evolutionary sequence which was proposed in the end of the 90s, I think, by Guillermo Tenorio Tagler, based upon these hydrodynamical simulations run by Sergei Silic earlier on in the 90s. So here they have been concerned maybe with the feedback from star clusters. Now, star clusters are typically thought of to be simple stellar populations. Everything forms, all the stars form in one go. They have developed and these feedback models that show very early times, you know, you have no star formation, you have no, so nothing happens, ISM is static and covered in H1, and after you run on time a little bit, you get some stellar winds and supernovae. These drive outflows, you have a strong radiative feedback in the middle here, you start to sweep up the shell. And at times like this, if you can ionize completely through your H1 halo from the very hard ionizing field, then you might be able to get a Lyman alpha emission line out. You run time on a little bit, part of this shell sweeps up, and you get lots of H1 atomic gas in the medium. It's going to be outflowing. You're going to get some kind of P Cygni-like profile there in these two stages here. And after a little bit longer, you're going to run out of ionizing photons. So then you're going to have no Lyman alpha. You're going to run out of also energy for feedback. And you end up with Lyman alpha turning off again. And this is for a single cluster, right? But we know this is a situation in which all the stars are formed one time. And we sometimes refer to this as an instantaneous burst. I'm going to look at that in a tiny bit more detail now. This is what you expect from the ionizing population of ionizing output as a function of time. So you have wavelength here. This is 1,000 in log here, so 3. So that's the Lyman edge there. This is all your ionizing flux is this stuff down here on this side. And key points in this are at 1 or 0 mega years. Your ionizing budget is extremely high. You have all of the most massive stars around, but you haven't had any time yet to develop any winds. You only have the winds from O stars, and they have just turned on, so your feedback has not yet dumped a large amount of mechanical energy into the ISM. About 3 mega years, we're here. We've lost half a dex in ionizing energy, and the first supernovae go off. So now we have some feedback from massive star winds, massive stellar winds, and also we have the budget from supernova, but we're still looking at the very, very top end of the IMF, and the IMF is a steep power law. So there are very few stars going supernovae at this time. About 8 million years in, right, we've gone from this 3 here, there's 10, and your ionizing budget has gone down by 2 orders of magnitude, so you've lost 99 out of every 100 of the ionizing photons you had in the beginning. But now you have quite a lot of supernovae, which is great, because now you can drive out an outflow, and you have lots of mechanical energy you can dump into the ISM, and you can heat it, and you can drive an outflow. Unfortunately, you're not going to see any Lyman alpha, because you've lost your ionizing stars. And then this continues until maybe 30 mega years, I think, 30, 40 mega years, when the very last supernovae go off. And then you have no ionizing stars and no mechanical energy. Which is, so we have a situation where the bulk of the ionizing photons are produced at a time when you haven't really had very much feedback. And by the time you get most efficient feedback, well, then you haven't got any ionizing photons left. So, damn. This is the wind, sort of the structure of galaxy winds as proposed by Tim Heckman, like 1990 now. Heckman, Armas, and Miley, I think it was. But you have a galaxy disk down here, and you have lots of star formation going off in the middle. You're like in this like nuclear starburst type environment. And you have here, you have many supernovae, and they all collide right down here in the central regions. And this gas, I mean, all these ejecta from winds and supernovae, they all collide, and the gas shock heats to be extremely hot, almost 10 to the 8 Kelvin, and this expands, it adiabatically expands, and just to blow out away from the central region. Here you have winds shock heating and dragging up other stuff. You enter this snowplow phase where it's the wind, this hot gas is coming, expanding and piling up all the ambient ISM in, possibly into something that looks a bit like a shell, not really sure. And this reaches, this wind continues to expand, blowing stuff out, reaches a few scale heights of the disk, becomes unstable. You get this fragmentation due to Rayleigh-Taylor instabilities. This is breaking up this original shell that we had into this clumpy cloud-like structure. So we have, you know, a supernova going off in the middle, producing outflows, look a bit like a shell for a bit, perhaps, and then they become unstable, the whole thing becomes clumpy. So when the whole thing becomes clumpy, this is what we're going to see perhaps as a, what do you call it, multi-phase ISM with dense clouds in it. This is where we're going to be, our measurements of the covering fraction are going to recover covering fractions less than one. And this kind of model is putting these two things together, leaving the simple stellar population approximation, has allowed people like Miguel Mas to generate these, put it this Lyman alpha sequence into more of an evolutionary perspective appropriate for galaxies, where you have a disk, you have this outflowing media coming away from the disk, blowing out into the galaxy halo. And this is one way we can explain the absence of emission from these extremely metal-poor dwarf galaxies, right? They're young. They have very high gas fractions. They have very low metallicities. And if you look at their ultraviolet spectra, if you look at their optical emission lines, you know that the stellar population in these systems is very, very young. We're talking really something like simple stellar populations at only a few mega years old. Then indeed, we won't have had very much time for a large number of supernovae to go off. And that could explain this very strong damped absorption you see in these dwarf galaxies. Dwarf galaxies are, you know, they're pretty special. This is where you see that the ISM absorption lines are not blue shifted. This is where we see that there's not evidence for strong winds. And this could be right-ish. I mean, qualitatively correct. And then after some time, you know, you develop a wind, you enter this perhaps snowplow phase, if you want to call it that. You're sweeping out, driving out material. This is where we enter this P Cygni phase, where you see Lyman alpha absorbed on the blue side because the shell is outflowing, and most of the red at end can probably stream freely out of the galaxy or with a smaller number of scatterings. And maybe if you can ionize the bulk of the halo, you can even get symmetric Lyman alpha emission observed, or blue peaks observed in a small number of star, well, probably a minority of local star-forming galaxies. Here's this thing again. One's Wiki 18. Dwarf galaxies so young they may not have driven out, but it's possible. So I would like to try and put all this stuff together now. We're going to play a little game first. So this is how we put it all together. I want to put, you know, not only Lyman alpha emission from galaxies together, but also this school. And probably I should start with this spectrum, this lovely image. Here we are, an ALP. That's good, that's where we are. And Lyman alpha spectrum, also where we are. So firstly, I would like to point out the atrocious fit here in the red wing. You know, probably that's okay because it's telling us a vital component of our model is missing. So, you know, we learn stuff. Now, really? You think, do you? Okay then. We're going to come back to that maybe in about a slide or two's time. So, little game. I was inspired by X's first lecture. A little game about identifying the spectral regions in quasar spectra. Oh, sorry. Okay. So the first person to shout out the wavelength region in the full spectrum, and I haven't shown it yet, wins a prize. Ready? The first person to shout it out. Let's say no. Go. You see it? Anybody see it? The wavelength axis is down here. Between
1,000 and 1,350.
Fuck. Okay. Okay, you win. Yep. Yep. I can't say it wasn't right. Okay. I can't say it wasn't right. It's a low resolution spectrum. Okay, so Anne made the claim that this was based upon real data. Okay, if that's the case, then part two of the game is to identify the object. Does anybody know what the object is? Anne, perhaps? The yellow one. Or this one. What is it? Sorry? A quasar, but which quasar? Who said that?
It's the only one.
The only one you know by name. Congratulations. Okay, part three of this game. I really hope you're paying attention at the back. Which telescope first observed the Lyman alpha spectrum of 3C273? Some of the people have been listening. Okay, so you don't need this. There's the spectrum I showed many times. There it is. Okay. We're going to do some astrophysics in a minute. Sorry?
Drop your weapons, earthlings.
Yeah. Exactly. So, here's the mess, right? Lyman alpha emitting galaxies are or have lower stellar mass, and they're younger and they're more compact, and they have higher H alpha equivalent width. They're bluer, less dusty, limitless. I'm running out of breath. More strongly ionizing, lower H1 mass, faster outflows, lower H1 covering fractions and column densities, larger halos, more turbulent ionized ISM. And the dwarf galaxies don't fit into the situation very well. It's this point again, right, that there's two ways you can approach, making progress. You know, when we do studies and when we write papers about these things, we have to come up with a focus for our papers and our studies. And we can cast the question in two ways, which is what makes, so which of these quantities here are going to be things that really enter into the problem of what makes the escape fraction high, or often you see written in proposals, we will determine the order of precedence or the most important quantities that govern the escape of Lyman alpha in astrophysical environments. That's escape. When you use the word escape, it's almost irrelevant what the input spectrum is. You know, you could imagine some kind of elliptical type galaxy, doesn't have an ISM. Probably you would get a high Lyman alpha escape fraction if you were to inject any Lyman alpha photons. And the other side of it is, what are these things we're recovering in all of Masami Uchi's surveys, all of the stuff that he showed us? What actually makes a Lyman alpha emitter? I mean, questions are, of course, related, and they're related into the way that we talk about properties of the transfer medium, where we talk about dust abundance and its distribution and the H1 kinematics and its geometry and how all this stuff plays together. And when we talk about what makes a Lyman alpha emitter, I said all this earlier, I think, we talk about stellar evolutionary phase and star forming environment and the metallicity and all stuff about the intrinsic spectrum of the stars. I mean, stellar evolutionary models, recent ones in particular, you know, it's not certain how much ionizing radiation these things are producing even. And it's all that, what makes Lyman alpha emitter is all that, combined with all this. It's complicated. And then you can add stuff in as well. You can make stuff up, like you can change the initial mass function and say there's some special stars around, or add in, I'm making this up, I did it over there at the back, but you can change the number of X-ray binaries that can change the state in the ISM. Include very different stars or change the composition of dust and play with the extinction laws and the distribution. So the task that I would like you to do in the next 5 minutes, I think, is to turn to the person next to you and take this big list here and sort them into quantities that are related to either the production of Lyman alpha or probability of escape. And then I shall write them up on the board, and when you're done with this, I shall publish a paper on it. Just 5 minutes. And that can be a permeable line if you want.
To the audience.
This thing's off, right?
No, it's not. Did you mute it? You can mute.
Yeah, okay. Consult with someone, Bill?
Sorry?
You want to consult with someone? No, you want to? No, you're doing fine.
Sorry,
okay. I asked if you wanted to consult with somebody, if you needed any help. It's okay. Okay, I think we're about halfway through this in terms of time now, so I reckon that's roughly enough time to start writing stuff on the board. I know, I appreciate that there's a large number of tasks in this sub-task, so... Right. Would anybody like me to tell me if a low stellar mass can be put into this system anywhere? More effective feedback. So what does that count as?
Escape.
Nice. Age. Sorry? Good. Compactness.
Escape.
Why?
Because it's compact.
True. Why? Oh. Oh. Why?
Because the more compact classes have higher mass, then you produce more
Oh, this is an IMF argument. All right, okay. Well, I actually agree. Well, okay, I can't. Yeah, okay, fine. If you're going to let the IMF be variable, then that's true. So, okay, what was this again? Compactness. I was going to write compactness here, but I'm going to write it in the permeable medium here. Compactness. And the reason I was going to write it here is because, I mean, feedback is supposed to be more efficient in thermalizing the ejecta from supernovae in more compact environments. But okay, and then you can drive winds more efficiently. Okay, HR for equivalent width, is that a thing? Or does it belong in one of these places? I mean, half of these are observables and half of them are physical quantities. It's kind of a mess, right? Blueness.
Escape.
Oh. Why production? Yeah, exactly. Why escape?
Dust.
I'm going to write a beta here, right? Less dusty. Lower metallicity.
Escape.
Why both? Why escape?
Dust.
Oh, so it correlates with dust. It makes the dust. Okay then. Where are we now? I lost it. Lower metallicity. More strongly ionizing.
Production.
Yeah, I think so. So, what was this? What do I write that with? What's the ionization? U, is it? Can I write U for that?
Sure.
U. Oh, or Q. That's true for ionizing photon production. Ah, but that's about shape, really, isn't it? More strongly. Oh, yeah. U plus Q. Okay, that's ionization parameter and the photon budget. H1 mass. Low. Okay, we'll do this one. That can go there, right? MH1.
I would say production for this exactly related to the ionization parameter you just wrote.
Oh, if we're doing it as the formal parameter, I suppose that's true. But I might actually be more inclined not to rub any more chalk off with the back of my wrist. Okay, where are we now? Faster outflows, right? Okay, well, I think we're all on the same page on this one. The exp. Silence. Lower H1 covering fractions. Yes, right. Okay, I don't want to hear that again. Lower H1 column densities. Yeah. Do I, as a lecturer, have the power to throw people out of the room? Yes? Oh, fantastic. It's really good when you've got a microphone. Larger Lyman alpha halos. Well, yeah.
Escape.
I'm not even sure it goes anywhere, but okay. Yeah, okay. Halo size. It's correlated there. Yeah, okay. Well, someone said it. And I wasn't prepared to argue. I want to get on. More turbulent velocity fields. Yeah, I think so as well. What did I call this? It was only this morning. V shear over sigma. Sigma. Can I take a photograph of this? And then I write it up. Submit it to Nature. Okay. Get it. So this is what I did this morning at the back of the room. I was concerned about lowering all this call it parameter space, or making all this more manageable within the samples that we have. So I started thinking about, well, what I can put right up together in terms of other quantities. So I can have stellar mass and I can have a metallicity, and I can write them together in one thing called the mass metallicity relation. And since mass is up here, I can actually throw in H1 mass as well, because it's going to correlate with stellar mass. And then I started thinking about things relating to scattering. So what the hell did I have more strongly ionizing? Ah, yeah, okay, we can reduce some of the H1 perhaps with that. And then we certainly have, if you reduce the H1 mass, you're going to reduce some scattering probably, or make less gas available. G change the outflow rate, you're going to reduce the scattering. Change the H1 covering fraction, you will reduce the scattering. Same applies to the column density. And I think I wrote halos there as well. Okay. And I started thinking more about dust-related things, bluer things, certainly less dusty. Less dusty things are certainly less dusty. And you can write, indeed, the metallicity here as well as being the thing, metals, silicon, carbon, that make dust. And then I start thinking about evolution-related things. Well, certainly stellar age, indeed, well, arguably compactness as well. This observable here is, can also go in, and the blueness certainly tells you something often about the evolutionary stage of the stars, or the age. Less dust is evolution-related. Oh, only in the sense that dust is built by star formation. And more strongly ionizing. Well, certainly you get more ionizing photons at young ages. And then there's some feedback stuff. Certainly compactness, I believe, is related to the efficiency with which you're going to be driving winds. I mean, you know, galaxies in the local universe have a given star formation rate. Most of them aren't going to have particularly strong outflows. And when you condense this star formation rate into a high surface density, then outflows emerge ubiquitously. So outflows, indeed, feedback, covering fractions from because of instabilities, also related to feedback. Column densities probably maybe also related to feedback. Turbulent velocity fields, not only, but possibly related to feedback. So to summarize all this, I did this. And that makes it completely straightforward. And then I thought, well, you know, dust, well, that's related to the made from metals, as I think Sally said a minute ago, mass made alone. So I could just write that in like that. And that's simple. And then I thought, well, this feedback-related stuff, that's related to stellar evolution, so I can write it like that. And then, what else did I think next? Well, scattering. Did I really think that? Okay, apparently I, for some reason, thought that scattering was related to stellar evolution. Oh, yeah, well, if it's about reducing column densities based upon feedback, it's going to be a property related to the stars. And then I thought, well, evolution, that's going to be driven by a star formation related to the mass of the galaxies. I mean, that's the star forming main sequence. You can't really argue very hard against that. So that's obvious. And then I thought that the evolution could be related to the feedback. I didn't already do that the other way. Yeah, I did. Okay, I've done that one twice. Well, you know, just shows I was right the first time. And then, well, I could feel perhaps I could write things up like this. So you have a large dark matter halo, and the dark matter, mass of dark matter halo is going to govern in some way how much mass it's got, how much gas it's getting, high redshift, how much it accretes out of the intergalactic medium, if that's the way galaxies get their mass. Galaxies get their dark matter halos get their gas, and that makes stars, and the stars make dust and metals and supernovae, and the supernovae drive the outflows, and the outflows disrupt and fragment the ISM. It reduces the covering fraction, and it makes channels of lower column, and the evolutionary scenario must emerge, right? And of course, I don't want to claim this is the whole picture. I don't want to claim it's even right. If it was this straightforward, of course, it would have been done already. But it does call, right, for us to do something about all of these quantities, right? We call them correlation analyses. I mean, rank sum tests. I mean, we look at plot Lyman alpha over H alpha on the y-axis and some quantity on the x-axis. We do this all the time. And then we make a, what do you call it, Spearman rho coefficient and compute the chance that it arose by statistical fluctuations. We've done it a lot, right? I mean, we have to take out some of these parameters. I'm thinking something like, you know, a fundamental plane of elliptical galaxies or a fundamental metallicity relation. I mean, we have to remove some of this noise. We need to have large samples of galaxies in which to do that, of course. We need to have more information than we have right now. We have, you know, 200 galaxy Lyman alpha emitters or 100 at less than redshift 0.4, where we can get really good follow-up, and we believe them to be mostly star-forming. We have roughly 100 galaxies observed at high resolution with HST COS, which is great. These numbers are good, but they're not good to, you know, run over 12 parameters in any kind of statistical test. So we have to reduce some of this complexity somehow, throw out some of these things. But we can do that. Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I mean, something like that. I mean, absolutely. I mean, I'm just saying, sorry?
Oh, you need a comparison sample, too.
Oh, yes, and control samples, of course. I mean, Len has them, and we also have, I mean, don't forget also that the majority of our, I say that there are spectra at Lyman Alpha, 100 of them. They're not Lyman Alpha emitters by construction.
Yeah.
There are selection effects. Many I showed this sort of Venn diagram of all these different HST servos, right? You know, there's probably 100 and something galaxies in there, and you know, HST deadline's 3 weeks away. Exactly. So we have 10 minutes left of this lecture. I would say we should dedicate 5 minutes to task number 2. 10 minutes left, really? All right, 4 minutes to task number 2. Which is to ask the question of what more observations you would like to have. Saying you want a stack more UV observations of galaxies is not an answer, okay? That doesn't count. Anything other than that, 4 minutes with the person next to you. What did I say that I wanted? Well, I wanted the SKA, right? I want, to know what the atomic gas is doing on small scales. I think that, to me, is really the key thing that we need to do that we really can't do right now. I want to see, you know, not having to work at 10 arcsecond resolution in the best current cases with the VLA. I want to be able to know where the atomic gas is, how it's moving, how clumpy it is, directly through its emission at 21 centimeter. I think that's the way I would like to proceed. I can either do that by waiting for the SKA, or we can bring Lyman Alpha samples very, very, very much closer. And for that, we need a new UV satellite. Or some way. What would be great, right? How does it work with suppression of air glow lines? If you could do that with the geocoronal line and observe things almost in the rest frame. Sorry?
You could remove the Earth's
atmosphere. I mean, yeah, sure. I think we had a worry about something like that in the 80s, and then people stopped using aerosols and made different fridges. And and I would also like to know how the Lyman Alpha spectral profile is built up as a function of position. I mean, we have a lot of spectra, right? We have lots of spectra of Lyman Alpha emitters and absorbers and whatever. There are all these aperture spectrographs taken down the barrel onto the UV point sources. It's fine in one position. He tells you the Lyman Alpha emission line profile on that position. It doesn't tell you what the halo spectrum looks like. I mean, you see, if you believe that all of the Lyman Alpha luminosity is dominated by extended halo emission, I want to know what that looks like, right? Because when you do a spectrum of a galaxy at high Z, you put everything into a 1 arcsecond slit, you get everything together, you don't know what's coming from where. You're never going to get the resolution to do that at high redshift directly. And so I would like to see, you know, I said something about doing high-resolution spectroscopy with something like STIS a few days ago. You could, you know, cut up a galaxy with STIS slits. You have to go deep. It's going to be, you know, you want high spectral resolution, so you need a small slit. And in a small slit, it's going to cost you a lot of photons, but maybe it's worth it. I'd also like to know how well we can actually predict observable. That's not really an observational question. Maybe I can forget about it. And of course, I want someone to think about proper statistical tests and reducing the parameter space in this problem. We have large data sets, right? We have, 200 galaxies with sufficiently good spectra at low Z. We haven't done a very good job with the statistics yet or homogenizing the data sets. I mean, some people have gone after this follow-up and that follow-up, and to exploit the modest statistical power that we have from space. We have all these observations from space. We haven't properly homogenized everything from the ground yet, and you've got to go and do that. That's your homework. So I'm done. This is my last slide. I want to say huge thank you to Anne and to Miriam and to Hakim and Pierre and Sebastiano, everyone that organized this meeting. It's been really, really cool to come and speak here, and I'm very honored to have done so. To the other teachers, Mark and Xavier and Masami, and to everyone that came and contributed and asked questions and talked. And I look forward to the rest of today. Thanks very, very much.